Get started. So welcome everybody to the second session of the Kidney Health Wellbeing Week. Today we're going to be talking about exercise and movement for kidney health, and I'm really delighted and thankful that Brett's come to join us today to share his expertise. My name's Karen Dwyer. I'm the Clinical Director of Kidney Health Australia. I'm a kidney specialist and also have an interest in lifestyle medicine. To begin with, I'd just like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands from which I'm hosting today's webinar, which is the Wadawurrung country of the Kulin Nation, and pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging. No doubt we have people joining us from across the country, and I acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands upon which you are living. And I also pay my respects to Aboriginal and or Torres Strait Islanders that may have joined us today. Just before we move on, I'd just also like for us to stop for a moment and think about those affected by the floods in New South Wales and Queensland, especially those from within the kidney community. And I'm particularly thinking about those that are trying to manage dialysis, for example, whilst also trying to navigate the flood situation. All right, so just moving on to today's webinar, I'd just like to highlight to start with how our movement channel, a challenge, and I'll just ask Brett's controlling the slides just to move the slides forward. Whoops, we've missed one, that's fine. So the Kidney Health Australia is hosting a movement challenge in collaboration with Fit Squirrel. The challenge is to try and move each day and to post some evidence of that on one of the social media channels, tagging both Fit Squirrel and Kidney Health Australia. And by doing so, you go for the chance to win a prize pack, which all sounds very exciting. So today's webinar is via Zoom, and just a little bit of housekeeping to start with. For those that would like to post a question, please post them to the Q&A box, and I'll be keeping an eye on those as they come through during Brett's presentation. If you have any technical issues or anything that you would like to speak to Kidney Health Australia directly about, please use the chat function. This session will be recorded, and a recording will go up on the website after the completion. And in the chat box, the phone number for Kidney Helpline will be posted. So that's a very useful resource for you to have should you have any queries about this or anything else moving forward. Now, just a little bit about our speaker today. We've got Brett Tarca with us, who's an exercise physiologist at the University of South Australia with over 10 years experience in the health industry. Brett teaches and educates the next generation of exercise physiologists, so we're very grateful that he's able to pass on his expertise. And really importantly for us today, Brett has an interest in the role of exercise therapy, particularly in those with kidney failure. And his current focus is exploring the relationship between physical activity, physical function, fatigue, mood, and adverse events for people receiving peritoneal dialysis. But I think a lot of what he's got to say will be applicable to everybody with some degree of kidney disease. All right, I will hand over to Brett now, and I will touch base with you at the end of his presentation. Enjoy.
Thank you, Karen, and thank you for the introduction. Thank you for having me today. Really excited to be here and sharing what I think is actually really great news, I hope, for all that are listening today. So very simply, I'm just going to be covering off on the why, the what, the how. As Karen mentioned, it is very generalised advice. It does apply pretty much to all people. So I hope that you can get something out of it, but please do ask questions along the way if there's something you're not sure about. So a great place to start is why we should move. And there are so many benefits on offer for people when they're engaging in exercise and an active lifestyle. And I've broken this up into three little categories. The first one, we know that those who engage in an active lifestyle have the ability to generate new muscle size and mass and the amount of, and also can be stronger as well. We know that people who engage in that active lifestyle actually improve their walking ability so they can walk faster and longer. We also know that people who are more active have good balance as well, which is really handy. We obviously want to try and prevent any chance of us having a fall. People who exercise tend to have a higher level of physical function. So physical function is this ability for us to do our day-to-day activities. So it then goes without saying that people who are exercising tend to have a lot more independence and the ability to maintain control over their life. And what goes with this is that increased sense of confidence. Not only the confidence that you're feeling good, but the confidence that you can have in your body and when you know what that you can perhaps do a physical task. This next lot of benefits, this relates more so to health conditions. And the two that I've got at the top there, blood pressure and diabetes, these are really important ones, particularly in the chronic kidney disease space. So we know that people who engage in exercise and activity can actually naturally reduce their blood pressure and help to naturally reduce their diabetes. And the way that this works is just by managing the blood sugar levels better. So we know straight away, great little advertisement for us to engage in that active lifestyle. We also know that we can improve our heart health, our lung health, and also our mental health. And it doesn't matter if you already have one of these conditions, you can help manage it and actually improve it. And if you don't have one of these conditions, well, that's great. You can actually help lower the risk of actually developing one. So again, a really great advertisement for engaging in that active lifestyle. This last one here, this is actually signs and symptoms that often actually come with chronic kidney disease. And what we know about exercise and activity is we can help lessen the effect of these. So fatigue is a really big one. We can help lower those levels of fatigue and give us more energy on a day-to-day basis. Shortness of breath, we can definitely help in reducing that. We can offset any kind of muscle weakness that might be happening. We can enhance our sleep quality and we can improve our mental sharpness. So mental sharpness relates to our ability to remember or our attention. This can be improved when we engage in more activity. And what we know about all these benefits on screen is that ultimately it's going to lead to enhanced quality of life. Another little note I just want to mention, I didn't just put this slide together and think of every health benefit known. These are all benefits that have been seen in people who live with chronic kidney disease. So please don't think that because you have a kidney condition, that this doesn't mean that you won't get all the benefits. You 100% absolutely will. So now we know why we should be exercising or completing activity. It's important to know that these are actually two different things. So when we think about exercise, we might often think about some of the more conventional types of exercise. So running or walking or swimming or doing weights, we might do them pretty regularly or two or three times per week and a bit of repetition and structure about it. But what often gets overlooked actually is this concept of activity or physical activity. Physical activity just involves moving about. If you're sitting still, you're not being physically active. If you're not sitting still, then you are being physically active. And often it involves things that we do on a day-to-day basis. It might be mopping the floors. It might be gardening, walking the dog, washing windows. All of this requires movement. All of this requires energy to complete. So it often gets overlooked, but it also counts towards what you should be doing each day. So what can I do? And you know what? I could spend a very long time talking through the things that you can do. And the answer is that you can do almost anything that your body will permit you to do. So it's very specific to what you are actually able to do. But just know that you can be playing some sports. You could be engaging in some very group fitness classes, or you might be able to go to the gym or doing exercise in your house. The key message I want you to take away from today is do what works for you. It has to be about what you like. If you don't like it, there's a very big chance that you're not going to be able to stick at it. So find what you like doing, and that's a good place to get to start. In terms of how much you should be doing, 30 minutes a day is roughly around about what you might often hear, particularly from a natural perspective. Don't get put off by that just yet. We'll talk about what we can do about that 30 minutes in just a moment. But just note there that I do mention it's exercise and or activity. So it can be a combination of both or one or the other. We should be trying to do strengthening activities twice a week. This is really important, particularly in chronic kidney disease. We really have to work on maintaining our muscle, particularly as we get older. It is that old adage, move it or lose it. So we should be trying to do some strengthening activities. And just some general lifestyle advice is we should be active on most days. We want to be trying to cut down that time spent sitting. As a rule of thumb, I normally say limit your time spent sitting to 30 minutes. After 30 minutes, we should be jumping up, stretching about, just moving about the room. I don't mind if it's only 1 to 2 minutes before you return back to your whatever it was that you were doing at that time. But try and be active. Try and cut down that time spent sitting. It's some really simple lifestyle tips to get going with. One of the keys about all of this, though, is it's about building it into your life. It's about making it a habit. We need consistency. It's not really great if we do once a month. We want to try and build it into our lifestyles. And I understand we can't always do everything in a day or in a week, and that is fine, as long as for the most part we are getting in some activity and cutting back on that time spent sitting. It's a great place to start. Some common questions and concerns that I normally get from people with chronic kidney disease: will exercise hurt my kidneys? Great news, no, it could actually help them. If you remember back to one of those first slides, all those benefits in terms of reducing the effect of diabetes, helping lower blood pressure, maintaining your heart health, these are all things that are gonna have a positive effect on the kidneys. But no, exercise will not hurt your kidneys. I received dialysis, can I exercise? Great news again, absolutely, both during and outside of. So if you are interested in doing some exercise or activity during dialysis, this is actually a conversation you're gonna have to have with your treating care team, because there are some things that you're just gonna have to be mindful of. But that doesn't mean that you can't be doing them. Outside of dialysis, absolutely. Yes, you have to show some care to the catheter or the fistula site. And again, this is a conversation that you should be having with your treating care team, but you can be exercising, most importantly, if you do receive dialysis. I haven't exercised in years. 30 minutes of exercise is too much. And do you know what? No problems. Break it up or start small. I can't stress this point enough. No one ever said you had to do 30 minutes in a single instance. It is perfectly acceptable if you did a 5 to 10 minute bout in the morning, at lunch, at night. It's about what you're doing across the day. Doesn't matter if you want to do it all in a single instance, by all means, that's fine. But just know it's about volume across the day. When people talk about doing 10,000 steps a day as a goal, no one ever said it had to be in one hit. Okay, so you are free to break it up. If 30 minutes as a whole is too much for you, no problems again. Start small. Remember that, as I said, it's about working it into your life, and going too hard too soon normally doesn't end too well. So start with 5 to 10 minutes every few days, completely fine. It's about what's going to work best for you. And it's about, as I said, incorporating it into your life. I've bunched these two questions together. I don't know how to exercise or what to do. I have other injuries and health conditions. What should I do? And the answer is the same here. And that's that you should see an accredited exercise physiologist. And there are two ways that you can do this. You can talk to your doctor, and you might be able to access the referral under an enhanced primary care plan. Or you can go to that website there, ESSA.org.au. There's a great box on the front page, and it's find my nearest exercise physiologist. There's over 15,000 in Australia. There'll be one near you. But I can tell you now that exercise physiologists are very well qualified to handle both of those questions and will be able to find a way to get you moving. I hear this one a lot, not just for people with chronic kidney disease, a lot of people. I don't want to go to a gym. Great news again, don't go. You don't have to. What I'm about to show you very quick, is things that you can do just around the house. It's very likely that you've actually probably got everything in your house that you actually need. So if you don't want to go to a gym, you don't have to. I'm not here to tell you that you do. With that in mind, I've put together today my super six. So my super six exercises that you can do just in the house if you want to. Now, this is just six. There are literally hundreds of things that you can be doing in the house. And straight away, I just want to acknowledge why you can see cans of soup, milk, bands, wood, and brick there. Well, because when we talk about doing strengthening activities, we have to lift some kind of weight. And often people think that they have to be using a dumbbell. Not true. No one has yet to tell me the difference between a 1 kilo can of tomatoes versus a 1 kilo dumbbell. They weigh the same. Sure, one looks better, that might look better than the other one, but they're still going to have the same effect. So that's what I mean when I'm saying you probably have everything in your house already. So with that in mind, I'm going to be the demo today. So I'm just going to move slightly back from the computer and take you through these exercises, which don't involve fancy equipment at all. So the first one is a shoulder exercise, and what I've got here, two cans of tomatoes, as I've mentioned, perfect little exercise and a great substitute for a gym dumbbell. If you'd like to do this one, just find something that's probably a suitable weight for you, and keeping in mind to just always start gentle when you're lifting weights. There's nothing to gain by lifting too heavy too soon. You'll probably end up really sore and not be able to move properly for a few days. Remember, it's all about consistency. So to do a shoulder exercise, I'm just sitting in my chair. I'm sitting nice and upright. So I always used to call it at attention. I've got my cans of soup just level with my shoulders. You can't quite see the end points, but I'm just pushing them up over my head. They're not touching at the top. I'm just pushing them up over my head before returning back down. Very simple exercise just to work on these shoulder muscles. The next one there is a chest exercise. Again, you don't actually need, you don't need any weight. You just need your body weight. Now, you can do this as easy or as hard as you like. So I'm using my dining table there. You can use a desk. What I would actually encourage you to use first, though, is a wall. So I'm just going to porch back to this wall here. A nice sturdy wall is a great place to start in terms of where you would like your hands to be. You want your hands starting just underneath your shoulders. And if I was to demonstrate the action that I would want you to do, it's basically imagine someone is walking straight towards you and you want to push them away. Okay, so I often see when people try and do a push-up, they have their hands out here. Don't do that. Just down there, someone's walking towards you and just push them away. So I know it's a little hard to see in here. So I'm not going to go against the wall because you'll see the back of me, which is probably a little bit defeats the purpose. But please feel free to ask any questions you like about this one. But just know a wall is a great place to start. As soon as those hands start coming closer towards the ground, it's going to get harder. You're going to have more strength in this upper body to actually maintain that. The third exercise I have there is a tummy exercise. And again, all you need is just a nice sturdy wall. And all I'm doing with this one is I'm actually just holding it there. So what you can see is I'm on my elbows. I've got my elbows straight underneath my shoulder. I'm just looking at the wall. Again, I start close to the wall. And all I do is walk my feet back. I'm just walking away from the wall just until I can feel a little bit of tension in my stomach. And not too much tension. You don't want to absolutely challenge them because it's the core muscles. If we don't have our core muscles, we lose that protection around our back and our spine. But as you can see from that photo, I'm just on a slight angle. So I'm just challenging those stomach muscles to make sure that my back stays nice and straight and my spine stays nice and protected. So that's the first three exercises. And so far, all we've needed is a couple cans of tomatoes. The third one involves the use of a band. I'm not sure if you're familiar with them. They're fantastic pieces of equipment, very inexpensive, can be picked up very cheaply from many stores. I'm off the top of my head, Kmart, Big W, Target, or you might be able to get one out of your physio or your doctor, but there are literally so many different things that we can be doing with these bands. And as you can see in that fourth exercise, that back exercise, I'm doing a pulling exercise. So all you need to do in this one is just find something to loop the band around. For the sake of today, I'm just going to be using my foot. All I'm doing then is I've got the weights in my one end of the band in my hands. I'm sitting up nice and out of tension. I'm just pulling it into my rib cage. And at the same time, I'm actually pretending that I've got a $100 note between my shoulder blades. So every time I'm pulling in, I am squeezing my shoulders together, trying to clutch onto that $100 note to make sure that my back muscles are getting a nice little workout. The fifth exercise there is a leg exercise. And I like to just call this one a chair hold. So again, all you need is just a nice sturdy wall. And this one I probably can just fit in the screen to show it to you. A good place to start, stand nice and up against the wall. You can have your back resting up against the wall. Just walk your feet out until they're roughly around about 2 or 3 foot lengths away from the wall. And then all I'm going to do is slowly slide down. And I'm just going to slide down until I feel a bit of tension in my legs, not too much, because if you go too low too soon, you might plonk yourself straight on the ground. But another thing I always advise people to do when they're doing this exercise is to keep something nearby just so you can put your hand on it just to support you, just to make sure that you don't go onto the ground. But just a nice, as I said, know your limit to begin with, slide yourself down, feel a little bit of tension in the legs. We're going to hold that for anywhere from 5 to 30 seconds, and then we're just going to slide our way back up. Again, another exercise that doesn't actually involve any equipment, just involves a nice sturdy wall. The last exercise you can see there is me walking my dog. I chose a footpath. However, for the sake of walking, you don't need to go on a footpath. You could walk around your backyard, walk up your hallway. I really don't mind. All that I'm going to really say when we're walking is that we should be walking a little bit above a comfortable pace. So just a little bit above it, just so our heart and our lungs are actually being forced to work just that little bit harder. But again, you don't want to be going too hard too soon. Know your limits, keep it as short as you need to, and just make sure that you're staying in control of that. As a rule of thumb, you should be able to have a conversation. I guess is a good starting point. So you might be working and you know about it, but you should still be able to talk to someone if they were to start talking with you. In terms of how much of this you should be doing, so for the shoulders, for the chest and for the back exercise, I normally say about 10 to 12 repetitions, or for the tummy or leg exercise, a 10 to 30 second hold of each twice through. But I cannot stress enough, start where you need to. It's okay to start smaller than that. It's okay to do two or three once a day, completely fine. As I say, it's about building it into your lifestyle. And if you think that it's too much and it's going to really fatigue or tire you out for days to come, start small. It's completely fine. The other little side note there is just to make sure you have a rest in between sets. If you are doing a couple of sets, just to make sure that we have time to recover before we go again. But some key messages from this presentation today is just know that there is so much to gain from moving about and engaging in an active lifestyle. There are so many ways that we can move. We don't always have to do a conventional exercise or activity. Find what works for you. And just know that you've probably got so many things around the house right now that you can be doing, which actually are going to help you get some of those benefits that we spoke about. Thank you very much. I hope I didn't go through that too quickly, but please ask as many questions as you like or as you need. So thank you very much.
That's great, Brett. I really enjoyed that. And there was lots of fabulous information. We've got a bit of time for a Q&A. So just a reminder, if anyone's got any more questions, just pop them into the Q&A box and I will work my way through them. So Brett, just in terms of those at-home exercises I think are fabulous and so easy to incorporate. You talked about the sort of we like to work up to 30 minutes of exercise a day on most days and across the week. What about where do you think your best bang for your buck is though? You know, do you have to get to that 150 minutes a week of exercise like the recommendations, or you know, do we see a big effect just getting moving right from the start, going from nothing to something?
Yep, absolutely. Something is always going to be fantastic. And I use guidelines because they're always a nice little round number to aim for. However, it's all about the individual and it's all about where you're at. Just as you said, I am just happy just to get people moving. I remember back in some of my early days, I was telling people just to move about for 1 or 2 minutes a day, which is such a long way from 150 minutes a week when you think about it. But that was such a massive effort for that person. And it was also an achievement when they did it. So please don't downplay if the fact that you're going from nothing to doing a couple minutes a day. That's fantastic. It's a really, Rome wasn't built in a day. You can't wake up and run a marathon or run 100 meters in under 10 seconds. It takes time. And it's about building it into your life. So yeah, absolutely. Just get yourself moving and just know that you can move.
Fantastic. And I think the evidence really does show that going from nothing to something is where you get the biggest effects on things like you mentioned before. And then you get further incremental effects as you move closer to the 150 minutes. So just remember, something is better than nothing. Mm. So just also on that, sometimes the week is really very busy and it's hard to even fit that into your schedule. But come the weekend, you've got time and you might want to do a bike ride or something. Is it all, what's the thinking about concentrating most of your activity perhaps to the weekend? Does that still confer the benefits?
Yes, absolutely. Yep. No, it's about, as long as you are consistent, it really is that the consistency is the key. So if you find that weekends are the only time that you get to dedicate to exercise and activity, absolutely, you're going to get the benefits, 100%. I don't want people to be deterred because they think, I just don't have time during the week. We have busy lives. And that's why I also like to mention as well this concept of activity. Don't discount some of the things that you're probably already doing on a day-to-day basis, which actually do count as physical activity. So absolutely, we're going to see those benefits if you are dedicating weekends to engage you in more exercise than, say, Monday or Friday.
Fantastic. And in some states, we call these people weekend warriors, but apparently not in South Australia. So that might be a Victorian thing to be known as a weekend warrior. Sometimes when we talk about exercise, we also talk about an exercise prescription. And you gave us a bit of an exercise prescription for those home-based exercises. Can you outline what are the specifics of an exercise prescription for somebody that you
So we normally go by the FIT principle. So the FIT principle is frequency, intensity, time, and type. So frequency is how often we're going to be doing it. So if I was to use the example of those exercises, I'd be saying do them perhaps twice a week. Intensity, if you remember for the walking that I said, you should just be going slightly above the normal. So if I was to even use a scale out of 10, if 5 was to be your sort of rest, I'd say aim for about a 6. So just slightly above that. Time, this is hugely dependent on where you're at in terms of your actual your body condition. It might be 5 minutes of walking and once through the strength exercises. So I can't really put a time on that because everyone goes at different speeds. But let's just say 10 minutes a week. Type, we're gonna, if there was some strength and there was also some, I call them huff and puff activities, the aerobic stuff. So that would be how I could apply that principle. But that principle can apply to anyone. You can go away and take the FIT principle and put in exactly what you think you can do. And it's a really great place to start because once you can get it out of your head onto a piece of paper, it's actually a bit of accountability on yourself. You put it on paper, you've got a plan, now it's about executing.
Perfect. And it really engages that SMART principle, something that's specific and measurable. Yeah. And mixing it up is great. And we've got one of our attendees who swims once a week and on which is a good all-rounder exercise with cardio and strength, and then walks the dog and the baby on other days. So well done to Jessica. You're nailing it. So that's fantastic. In terms of, so just so that you know, we'd like a copy of those exercises. We've got a request if you're able to share the soup brand or maybe the tomato brand. Is that important in those cans? No, just the exercises will do then. That's great. Sure. Just some specific questions. So exercise and bone health. You didn't really touch on bone health as one of the benefits, but
Absolutely. No, it's... wonderful benefits of bone health. It can obviously keep our bones nice and strong. This is obviously really important as we get older, particularly, I don't mean to be any way slanting towards one gender, but particularly for females as they get older, there's a lot of great benefits on offer to make sure that we're maintaining nice and strong bones, to make sure that we're not going to be suffering from any fractures. Or if we have a fall, to make sure that nothing breaks. But no, I apologise. You pulled me up there. I've definitely overlooked that one. But no, bone health absolutely gets a great benefit from strength training.
Beautiful. Excellent. Now, we've got somebody whose daughter has a kidney issue and wants to play Aussie rules football and is interested to hear about a kidney guard. So do you want to talk a little bit about the role of a kidney guard?
Yeah, so a kidney guard, I could almost relate them to like superhero underpants in some respects. If you were to Google it, you'd probably understand what I'm actually meaning there. It is literally a padded guard that is designed to obviously absorb any impacts. I've seen them. I truthfully don't know how effective they are because I've never actually spoken to someone actually who's actually ever worn one and whether they've actually had any kind of hit or any kind of trauma to the site. But in terms of a protective instrument, sure, they appear to be protective, but I can't really testify whether that how good they are. I'm pretty sure they're going to do more positive than negative, but don't hold me to that. I just don't know enough. Sorry.
And maybe a sports physician might be the ideal person for something like that. So Brett, your expertise in peritoneal dialysis, someone's asking for some specific information. Do you have a website or something that people can go to get that information?
In relation to it, just some exercise guidelines.
For peritoneal dialysis, yep.
Yeah, so we recently actually just put together some practice guidelines actually. So it's a long title and I'm happy to actually forward it on if I can pass on that information. And I'll happily forward on these exercise practice recommendations relating to activity and exercise. But just know that they are out there and we do want you to move, absolutely.
That'd be great. Okay, we're just about out of time. So some quick questions here. What about warm-up exercises before embarking on any sort of physical activity, Brett? What's your thoughts there?
Yep, so warm-up is good. I like an active warm-up though. So I do not like a static warm-up. I like anything that just slowly just helps build up the heart rate and build up the breathing. You shouldn't just go out and try and run 100 meters. So a nice place to start. It depends on what activity you're going to be doing. A nice brisk walk to begin with. And if you wanted to build that up to a jog, absolutely. If you were doing something that requires a bit more strength in the upper body, just doing some really gentle weights to begin with. And work that way up. Anything that's kind of like, think of it as going upstairs. You just want to start really small and work your way up, but make your warm up about what you're actually about to do. There's no point doing a big leg warm up when you're about to use your arms, say for going for kayaking, for example. So make your warm up specific to you, start small and just work your way up in intensity.
Yeah, great. So there's a couple of sort of specific questions here. Someone's got mesh after having a big operation and concern about stretching exercises. And I think it's very difficult to give that, to answer this one without a proper, you know, thorough assessment in person. So I'd certainly recommend speaking with your doctor or your treating nephrologist about that. As a general principle, exercise or physical activity is beneficial, but obviously we wouldn't want to cause any damage to any operative site. And someone's also talking about medications following a transplant that can impact weight gain. And a recommendation for an exercise to burn the most calories, which is probably not what exercise is there to achieve, again, perhaps a holistic approach to exercise for the transplant recipient. Brett, have you got some sort of general principles there?
Look, what we know, it's very limited evidence out there. We know that those who engage in activity post-transplant can actually potentially increase the longevity of the kidney. There is very small evidence, it's not conclusive, but this is just to engage in activity. In terms of specific prescription, yeah, it's very difficult, I'm sorry, without understanding the client's background, and particularly around medications, that's not my domain, so I apologise if I have to hand all that one off to the experts, which is your consultant. I think the other one was there about most calories burned, and I think you answered it really well there, Karen. Exercise is not so much about the actual burning calories. Actually, the benefits you get from exercise are all those health benefits that I showed you on the first screen. Focus on getting the heart, lungs stronger, keeping those kidneys as healthy as they can be, keeping yourself as healthy as you can be, strong and fit, I think is going to put you in a best place going forward.
Fantastic. And there's just two things that I would like to say at the end. You touched a little bit on medications, and I just think it's really important in a webinar with people that have kidney disease that non-steroidal anti-inflammatory, some people just call these anti-inflammatory tablets, which can be purchased over the counter and can be a very effective analgesic. We need to be very, very careful in using these in someone with kidney impairment. So I would caution anyone to take anti-inflammatory tablets without thorough discussion with their doctor. There's also anti-inflammatory gels. There's far less systemic absorption of the gels, and for a localized injury are probably safe, but still worth talking to your local doctor or you're treating nephrologist or whoever about. And just the last thing about, if you haven't been doing any physical activity and you want to get started, it is a good idea to talk this through with your local, with your doctor or your treating nephrologist, because if there's any concerns that we might have that you might have some heart disease or something else going on, we'd want to check that out before going on to do a exercise program. For many people, you can just embark on exercise, and if you're already exercising, that's fantastic. But just have that conversation with either your EP, your physio, your doctor, and it's always good to have sort of a team with you when you're embarking on such this sort of lifestyle change. Okay, so I think we're at time now. Just a reminder that there is the Kidney Health Line details have been popped into the chat box. I think we've covered just about all the questions. swimming's getting another tick for being a good all-round exercise, which is fantastic, and weight resistance training and yoga for body stretching. So we've got a really active group with us today. So thanks very much, everybody, and we look forward to seeing you tomorrow for our next session and Thursday. So in those sessions, we'll be covering stress management and sleep, so two other really good, important pillars of lifestyle medicine. Thanks very much, everyone.
Thank you.